I've analysed every single lap of the 2025 F1 season, yes, all 25 plus thousand of them, to try and objectively determine who was the best driver. In this video, we'll answer questions like who was the most consistent, who maximised their qualifying the best, and what about Racecraft? I'll score the drivers in each category as we go along, so stick around for the final rankings. Now, one of the most basic metrics to look at is average finishing position, but it really doesn't tell us much about the drivers as it's so car dependent. One interesting thing I did find though is that if we include DNFs in the calculation, we find Verstappen actually shoots to the top, and Russell also moves up thanks to having no DNFs. Of course, Verstappen only had that one in Austria. So then, how can we improve on this to get some insight or ranking that's more driver focused? Well, we could take each driver's results over the entire season and see how consistent those are. I've used something called the standard deviation to do this, which we'll come back to, but basically lower standard deviation means more consistent and higher standard deviation means less consistent. So here are the charts, both with and without the DNFs included, and this reveals a few issues with the method. Firstly, it's super sensitive to DNFs, and whether to exclude or include a DNF is difficult because sometimes they are the driver's fault and sometimes they aren't. We also see Alpine scoring well, low standard deviation, so good consistency. But when you think about it, that's easy to do if you're pretty much always the worst car on the grid. You're then always going to be finishing at the back. Sauber is then the opposite story. Their car was back of the grid one race and then on the podium or fighting the midfield Ferraris the next, so this method just really isn't a good measure of the driver's performance. I won't be rewarding any points for it. Now, although that method was bad, we were onto something with consistency. We can instead look much closer and actually look at the consistency of the driver's race lap times rather than just their end result, which is far more affected by strategy and the car. So let's take a look at some laps, the lap time on the y-axis and the lap number on the x-axis along the bottom. First, we remove the outliers, that's the opening lap, any laps under safety car or VSC, as well as the in and out laps into the pits. These laps are all much longer than the typical racing lap and include factors like pit stop time, which ultimately is entirely out of the driver's control, so they need to go. We can now find the standard deviation of these lap times. The formula for doing this may look complicated, but what you really need to know is that we're taking the average lap time and then seeing how far away from this all the individual laps are. An inconsistent race will have many laps far away from the mean average, leading to a high standard deviation, whereas with a consistent stint, the laps are overall going to be much closer to the mean, leading to a low standard deviation. Now, we could just do this on the driver's dataset of lap times for their whole race, but there's a slight issue with that. This is a representation of Verstappen's dataset at Monza, a very consistent race. But you'll notice that the later hard tyre stint is much faster than the opening one, and this is fairly normal. But if we took the average, it would lie somewhere between these stints, so the gaps between it and the lap times would be huge. The standard deviation would come out big, and just from the number, we'd wrongly assume it was an inconsistent race. To fix this, I'm going to group all of the race lap times by stint, so we just work out the individual standard deviation of each stint and then average those out. I've also used a weighted average to do this because let's say we have a case like Qatar where drivers, or at least most drivers other than those McLarens, were pitting after a super short 7-lap stint. We don't want that 7-lap stint to have an equal weighting with the other stints in the race that were something like 3 times as long. Then from this, we get an overall standard deviation score for each driver at each race. But when we actually see how this plays out, it's a little bit all over the place. Australia has standard deviations 3 times higher than the other races. If we think about it, it was wet, drivers make more mistakes, and the changing conditions also threw lap times all over the place. It's a similar story in Silverstone, which makes sense, but we don't want to be giving a higher weighting to these races, which is exactly what would happen if we just added these up as they are. Some tracks also just have longer laps, more corners, and therefore you would expect more natural variation. To improve this, I decided to normalise the standard deviations. For each race, I took the median average consistency and compared each driver's own deviation to this average of the whole field. Remember, low deviation means more consistent, so if a driver has a deviation plus 10% more than the average, they're 10% less consistent by this measure. If their deviation is minus 10% less than the average, they're actually 10% more consistent. And as messy as it looks, this new chart is now much more even, exactly as we hoped. We can get our final results by finding the overall percentage that each driver was away from the average consistency for the whole season. And here's the results, with drivers that were overall more consistent than average having negative percentages, and drivers who were overall over the whole season less consistent than the field having positive percentages. And this is very clearly pretty dominant for Verstappen, whose deviation is on average 22% less than the overall field. His gap to Piastri of 8% is also the biggest between any adjacent drivers on here, and his 23% gap to his teammate is also the largest between any teammate pairings. Russell has also driven super consistently, managing to split the McLarens, and Leclerc also very good, despite the tractor. Mega effort from Sainz too to be 9% more consistent than average, despite usually fighting a bit further back, meaning probably more traffic and dirty air, which is a factor that we're going to have to acknowledge just isn't accounted for here. The other three Red Bull drivers are also all pretty much equally matched, all sitting close to the grid average, which is interesting to see. And if we just head back to the race-by-race chart, you may have spotted this outlier for Hamilton at Singapore. You might be able to guess what it was. I initially thought maybe there was a calculation issue, but no, this was when his brakes decided to blow up. So I added in a feature to let us manually remove the outliers, and when we do this for Hamilton, his consistency score does improve to sitting much closer to the average. I also added a slider so we can change which races this is calculated over. In the first 8 races, for example, it was actually Piastri driving the most consistency, which makes sense, he was properly on form. And if you want to explore this data more yourself, it's one of the many F1 data tools available in my website, linked in the description. You can do this exact analysis on any season back to 2017, and of course access the usual race and session analysis that you'll see in my other videos. It's pretty much my version of a channel membership, which supports me making these videos. So for the sake of deciding an order, we'll award F1 style points to the top 10, but I'll make it double points for this section as it's the most robust. The others are a bit simpler with a few more concessions to make. So now moving on to qualifying. Again, we need a measure for performance which isn't too car dependent. I decided to look at each driver's ultimate lap time. This is where you take their best times in each sector throughout the whole qualifying session, smush them together to find their hypothetical ultimate time, and then we're going to compare this to the time that they put in to actually set their grid position. Now, it's not a perfect measure, but over the season it should show us which drivers leave more time on the table than others. A driver, for example, who can extract the best out of themselves and the car when it counts should have a very low, if not zero, difference between their ultimate and actual time. Again, to account for some tracks being longer, we'll take the percentage difference between actual and ultimate and then average this out for all the qualifyings over the season. And looking at the results, it's actually the Racing Bull drivers with the lowest average difference, meaning they're the ones possibly maximising most and they're super evenly matched, just like they were on consistency. You might also notice Tsunoda all the way back here is looking a bit suspicious, and when we look at this race by race, it's actually Vegas which was his outlier, where the team admitted they mucked up on his tyre pressures, so we'll remove that. And this actually brings him right into play. It shows his poor qualifying form wasn't due to being unable to put a lap together, like we saw from Hamilton quite a bit, and even from Norris at earlier points in the season, both of which reflect in this data. Overall, Piastri does therefore clear Norris by a notable margin, and also interestingly, when we just analyse the final 6 rounds, it's actually Verstappen who tops everyone. But once again, we'll award points for the top 10 over the whole season, which looks a bit like this. Next up is Racecraft, which to be honest is a nightmare to quantify. I decided that position change on the opening lap would be a decent proxy for it, since there's a lot of wheel-to-wheel action and smart racing decisions are needed to do well. It's not a perfect measure. It's harder or even impossible to gain a position from the front row, but it's much easier to from the back. So I looked at an even simpler measure. What percentage of the time did each driver manage to either hold or improve their position on lap 1? This is still imperfect, but relatively useful, and here are the results. It's Leclerc who maintains or improves his position most often, 87% of the time, which is a very impressive hit rate when you think about it. Both Haas cars, Verstappen, Alonso and Hamilton are close behind, with the McLarens way on the other side of the chart. The gap between the McLarens is also one of the bigger ones, Piastri holding or gaining 8% more of the time than Norris, despite nearly equal average starting positions between them. It's not like Piastri was half the time starting much further back than Norris. Hülkenberg and Alonso then also showed their experience, with gaps even larger over their teammates. Again, I'll award points, and this is what the standings come to. Now the final metric I wanted to look at is pole conversion rate. only applicable to some drivers, so the leaderboard will now only involve them. Yes, this is possibly the worst stat since so much strategy and car performance comes into this, but it's always interesting to look back on at the end of a season. Here are the absolute poles in white, conversions in yellow, and DNFs from pole in red, which is actually just Norris's disqualification for plank wear in Vegas. When we flip this over to percentages, we see Russell, of course, converted 2 out of 2. Verstappen then trails the McLarens, with Norris actually converting better than Piastri, and Leclerc with that one pole, zero conversion rate. Again, we can award points, and here are the final standings for just those drivers. It's Verstappen with a clear win, followed by Russell and Leclerc, and then Piastri, finally Norris. Please comment with how you would have ranked these five yourself. I'm interested to see if there's an accepted consensus and how close it is to what we've come up with here. I think I would maybe make a swap or two, but generally agree. Anyway, that's all the analysis I have for you. As always, the Discord link is in the description if you want to discuss all things F1 and its data analysis. And if you have enjoyed, then a like or even a sub would be mega. This video required over 1,000 lines of new code, so it is really appreciated. But that's everything, so thank you for watching, and I'll see you soon.